Math is a beautiful part of God's creation. But why? Sometimes it's the surprise factor. Sometimes it's how algebra and geometry come together to reveal beautiful truth.
Do you want to experience a beautiful and surprising mathematical fact today, whose truth is revealed by the algebra and geometry of imaginary and complex numbers? Get out your tools. Carefully draw an arbitrary four-sided polygon, called a quadrilateral. Use a ruler to draw the edges. There's our arbitrary quadrilateral. There seems to be nothing special about it. Use a protractor to measure out 8 90-degree angles, two at each vertex. Now use the ruler and the right angles to carefully measure out and draw four squares, one on each side. Now draw two diagonals in each square, identifying their midpoints. Finally, connect opposing midpoints. Stare at your drawing. Do you notice anything about these line segments? They should look perpendicular with the same length. That's our beautiful mathematical surprise. Is it a coincidence? The answer is no. If you've done it right, these line segments will be perpendicular and of the same length. But why? That's where mathematical proof comes into play. And now I'm going to show you a beautiful proof using complex numbers. A complex number, let's call it A, is a real number such as 3, plus another real number such as 2, times the imaginary unit labeled I. For this example, 3 is the real part of A, and 2 is the imaginary part of A, even though 2 is a real number. It's next to the I. What is I? It's a symbol that has the property that when you square it, you get negative 1. How do we know that such a number exists? We essentially define it to exist, and we'll see that it has a consistent and beautiful arithmetic. We'll also see that complex numbers have a consistent and beautiful geometry associated with them, based on the natural association between a complex number and rectangular coordinates in the plane. The complex number 3 plus 2i is completely determined by the real part 3 and the imaginary part 2. Therefore, those numbers can be thought of as rectangular coordinates. It's then very natural to use the words real and imaginary as the labels for our axes in a rectangular coordinate system. We can then plot the complex number a equals 3 plus 2i as the point 3 comma 2 in this rectangular coordinate system. Even better, we can draw an arrow, called a vector, from the origin to the point 3, 2, and think of that as the complex number 3 plus 2i. The main benefit of this is that we can then move the complex number around. The starting and ending points don't matter, it's the arrow, its length and direction, that matter. If we're going to prove what we want to prove about quadrilaterals, we need to understand how complex arithmetic is done and how it is geometrically interpreted. Let A be the complex number 3 plus 2i, and let B be the complex number 1 plus 4i. To add these two complex numbers, treat these as polynomials in I, and then add like terms. What is A plus B? Its real part is the sum of the real parts of A and B, 3 plus 1. Its imaginary part is the sum of the imaginary parts of A and B, 2 plus 4. The final answer is 4 plus 6i. The geometric interpretation of this sum is as follows. First, draw the vector for the complex number A equals 3 plus 2i. Next, draw the vector for the complex number B equals 1 plus 4i. Now translate that vector for B over until its tail is at the head of A. Do the same kind of translation for the vector A. And finally, draw a vector from the origin out to the meeting place of the translated versions of A and B, and you now have a vector for the sum A plus B equals 4 plus 6i. This is appropriately called the parallelogram law for complex vector addition. Notice, however, that it is redundant. We can get rid of one half of the parallelogram and still see that the sum is the vector that goes from the origin out to the point 4 plus 6i. This is the head-to-tail interpretation of vector addition. Put the tail of B at the head of A, and then the head of B, its tip, is where the head of A plus B should be. If we generalize this process, we can geometrically interpret the sum of any finite number of vectors, 2, 3, 4, etc. Start with the vector A equals 3 plus 2i, with its tail at the origin. Next, put the tail of B equals 1 plus 4i at the head of A. If we want to add another complex number, such as C equals negative 3 plus I, put its tail at the head of B. The final answer for A plus B plus C is 1 plus 7i, and this can be represented as a vector going from the origin to the point 1 plus 7i. an important consequence of this geometric interpretation of vector addition that we'll need for our proof about squares on quadrilaterals is that if the sum of a finite number of vectors brings you back to the origin, then that sum of vectors must be the complex number 0 plus 0i. Symbolically, complex number subtraction is done in a similar way as addition. If a is 3 plus 2i and b is 1 plus 4i, then a minus b is going to have real part 3 minus 1, which is 2, an imaginary part 2 minus 4, which is negative 2. The final answer here is 2 minus 2y. It's important to note here that a minus b plus b does simplify to a. The b and the negative b cancel. Here are the details. A minus b is 2 minus 2y. B is 1 plus 4i. When we add those, 2 plus 1 gives 3, and negative 2i plus 4i gives 2i. The result is 3 plus 2i, which is a. Because of this, a minus b can be visualized as the vector we need to add to b in order to get a. If we put the tail of a minus b at the head of b, its head is at the head of a. It's an arrow going from the head of b to the head of a. A full explanation of the arithmetic and geometry of complex multiplication is even more beautiful than addition and subtraction. We will be satisfied, however, by multiplying positive real numbers times complex numbers and also multiplying I times complex numbers. That will be good enough for our proof. Once again, we treat these things as if they are polynomials in I. If a is the positive real number 3, and b is the complex number 1 plus 4i, then a times b, 3 times the quantity 1 plus 4i, is found using the distributive property. We get 3 times 1 plus 3 times 4i, which simplifies to 3 plus 12i. Geometrically, multiplying a positive real number times a complex number rescales that complex number. 1 times b equals b itself. If I multiply b by a number bigger than 1, that makes the vector longer. 3 times b is 3 times as long as b. If the positive real scalar is less than 1, then that makes the vector smaller. 0.6b is 0.6 times as long as b. On the other hand, if a is the imaginary unit I and b is 1 plus 4i, then a times b, once again as found with the distributive property, gives I times 1 plus I times 4i, which becomes I plus 4i squared. Now, remembering the essential fact that I squared equals negative 1, this simplifies to negative 4 plus I. Geometrically, this can be visualized as a 90 degree counterclockwise rotation. B equals 1 plus 4i becomes I times b equals negative 4 plus I. B and I times b are perpendicular and they have the same length. That's important. In fact, here's a general truth that we need. Two non-zero complex numbers a and b are perpendicular and of the same length if and only if either a equals I times b or b equals I times a. Think back to our general statement about squares on quadrilaterals. Now do you see where this is going? Those line segments are perpendicular and they have the same length. And it doesn't matter what the quadrilateral is. It still works. Now let's look at the proof as found in Visual Complex Analysis by Tristan Needham. Start by drawing an arbitrary quadrilateral. Next, draw squares on each side. For convenience, let 2a, 2b, 2c, and 2d be the complex numbers represented as vectors along the edges of this quadrilateral. Since we come back to where we started, 2a plus 2b plus 2c plus 2d equals 0 plus 0i, which we'll just call 0. Dividing everything by 2 means a plus b plus c plus d also equals 0. That's going to be very important. We need to connect the opposing midpoints with complex vectors and show that those vectors are perpendicular and of the same length, that one is I times the other. The vector A is 1 half times 2A, and therefore goes to the midpoint of the first line segment. If I multiply A by I, that gives me IA, which is perpendicular to A, and when added to A, goes to the midpoint of the first square. Call that midpoint P. P is A plus IA. Now take 2A and add on B, bringing you to the midpoint of the second line segment. Multiply b by I to get I times b, which is perpendicular to b and of the same length. Adding on I times b therefore brings you to the midpoint of the second square. Call that midpoint Q. Q is 2a plus b plus IB. Doing the same kind of thing with the next square brings you to its midpoint. Call it R. R is 2a plus 2b plus c plus IC. Doing it for the last square brings you to its midpoint. Call its midpoint S. S is 2a plus 2b plus 2c plus d plus id. Now, based on the geometric interpretation of complex number subtraction, capital A equals S minus Q can be represented as a vector going from Q to S. In a similar way, capital B equals R minus P can be represented as a vector going from P to R. To show that capital A and capital B are perpendicular and of the same length, we will end up showing that B equals I times A, just like we talked about before. We will do this with some beautiful algebra. Keep in mind here that all the symbols involve complex numbers. However, purely abstract properties, such as the distributive property, still work. Recall first that A equals S minus Q. A was a vector that went from Q on the right to S on the left in the picture. Continuing, S equals 2A plus 2B plus 2C plus D plus ID, and Q equals 2A plus B plus IB. We can now distribute the minus sign through on the right. The two A's completely cancel, and then 2B minus B gives you B. Nothing else cancels. The final answer here is B plus 2C plus D plus ID minus IB. It's probably worthwhile for you to pause the video and write that down. Moving on, the vector B equals R minus P. It pointed from P in the top to R in the bottom in the picture. Substituting, R equals 2A plus 2B plus C plus IC, and P equals A plus IA. We can once again distribute the minus sign through the parentheses. This time, only 2A and A cancel to give you A. The final answer here is A plus 2B plus C plus IC minus IA. Pause the video here as well to write this down. The really beautiful part comes when we compute capital A plus I times capital B and see what happens. Capital A is B plus 2C plus D plus ID minus IB, and capital B is A plus 2B plus C plus IC minus IA. Now, distribute the I through the parentheses on the right, you get this expression, and now stare at this expression. Only a couple things partially cancel. One thing that partially cancels is the 2C and the minus C to give C. Another thing that partially cancels is the 2IB and the minus IB to give IB. When you do that and factor out an I, you get A plus B plus C plus D plus I times A plus B plus C plus D. But remember, A plus B plus C plus D was 0. This is 0 plus 0i, which we can just call 0. We're almost done. Since A plus IB equals 0, we can subtract IB from both sides to get that A equals negative IB. This in and of itself is enough to say that A and B are perpendicular and of the same length. I can also multiply both sides by I and write this as IA equals B, because I times negative I equals 1. We are done. A and B are perpendicular and have the same length. That's what we wanted to prove, and this is true for squares on any quadrilateral.